Proverbs chapter 20. Nope, not verse 10.
You missed it.
I missed it. Brian heard from God and I did. Yeah. Let me read verse 10. No, that's a pretty good one. They're all good, aren't they? But let's pray here for a minute. There's some folks that need prayer. Javier Garcia's mom passed away last week. And talked with him this last week. And, you know, he's at peace. He knows it was time for her to go on to be with the Lord. Let's just pray for them. Also for Chance Alexander. He broke his foot. And so we need to pray for him. And then Josh Upshaw, pray for complete healing of his eyes. And also that it says that we have wisdom to hear what God has for doors of hope. Linda's ministry over there, the ministry she's over there, they're needing to move, have a building, things change, and the Lord has already got it figured out. And we're just going to agree with that, amen?
Yes.
So, Father, thank you tonight.
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you. We lift these up right now. We lift others up. If there's someone here who is praying for another, we lift them up before you right now. We know you've got the answer to all of it, Lord.
Yes.
We ask you, Father, in the name of Jesus, by the blood of the covenant, to come and to touch lives,
yes,
to heal bodies,
you,
to bring forth that which you have given us through your covenant, through the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, I thank you for this situation with Doors of Hope. You've been behind this, with this. This was not Linda's idea, it was your idea. And where you guide, you provide.
Yes.
And when it's your will, it's your bill. And so we thank you, Lord, that they don't even have to fret, that you're going to open the doors for them. And if I know you, Lord, you're probably getting ready to promote them in a great way. We thank you for that. We praise you for it. We agree with your will, plan, and purpose for that ministry in the name of Jesus. Lord, help us tonight as we share the word of God. Give us, as we've already prayed, eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart that discerns. Lord, we need to hear from you. Sometimes we need to hear things we've already heard from you and to be renewed in our faith and in our confidence. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want to talk to you tonight a little bit about, the spirit realm. You know, 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says that we are a spirit. We have a soul, and we live in a body. We're made in the likeness and image of God. God is one God manifest in three parts, or three persons, if you want to say it that way. And so he's a triune being, and he created us in his image. The same way, we're a triune being. We are a spirit. The real you, see, I've never seen the real you. Matter of fact, you've never seen the real you.
Right.
When you look in the mirror, you see the house you live in, the temple, the body. But you've never seen the real you. The real you lives on the inside of that body.
Yeah.
Amen? We are a spirit. We're not a human having a spiritual experience here on earth. We're a spirit having a human experience.
Yeah. Amen.
And, you know, the victory or the power and the victory that we have is in the spirit.
Yes.
Jesus died on the cross purposely and stepped over his spirit, left his body. He stepped over into the spirit realm where the devil lives, where angels live, where God lives, that realm, that spirit realm that's unseen to the natural realm. And he obtained our victory in the spirit. The Bible says the first man, Adam, was made a living soul, but the second Adam, Jesus, the last Adam, was made a quickening spirit. Hallelujah. Quickening, alive. And so he won the victory for us there. He took the authority that the devil had obtained through deception with Adam and Eve. He took that back. He paid the price for us. Praise God. And then he rose from the dead and went back into his human body for a short period of time. He spent a short period of time on this earth. And, you know, he told his disciples, "All right and might has been given unto me in heaven and earth. Now here, I'm giving it to you. I'm transferring it to you again. You go and make disciples of all nations." And then, of course, he rose up and he went into heaven, where he's there now as our great high priest, as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But the thing I want you to understand is that the spirit realm is where we need to operate and where we need to come from.
Yes.
Where we need to understand. I heard a man of God years ago say this, I've never forgotten. He said, if you let the devil take you into the natural realm, into the reasoning realm, or the emotional realm, or the physical realm, and you try to fight him, or you try to overcome him in those realms, he'll beat you every time.
Yes.
Because he can manipulate those realms to deceive you. Mm-hmm. But if you keep him in the spirit realm,
yes.
Why? You'll beat him every time. Why? Because the Word of God is spiritual.
Yes.
The Holy Ghost lives in the spirit realm. Angels live in the spirit realm. God himself lives in the spirit realm. So we need to operate from, we need to learn how to operate from our spirit and the Holy Spirit that's in us. And it says here in Proverbs chapter 20, verse 27, it says, the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly.
Okay.
This is the old King James translation, of course. But what's being said here is our spirit is where we're enlightened.
Amen.
There's two kinds of knowledge. There's sense knowledge and there's revelation knowledge. Sense knowledge is knowledge you obtain through your five physical senses. You can smell something, see something, feel something. But revelation knowledge is, it's what this verse is about right here. When Peter had the right answer for the question Jesus asked, who do men say that I am and who do you say I am? And Peter said, you are the King, you are the Messiah, you are the Anointed One. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus got excited about that. And he said, Peter, you are blessed. And if you look at that word blessed in the original language, it means you're operating like God operates. In other words, Peter wasn't trying to figure this out like all the other men they talked about. Well, you're John the Baptist raised from the dead, or you're this, or you're Elijah, or this. He got a revelation in his human spirit by the Holy Spirit. His light bulb came on, so to speak. There was an enlightenment that came to him. And he realized this is not Joseph's son. This is just not some anointed prophet. This is that one that's been prophesied to come. He got that information spiritually. Amen? Praise God. And when you get information from the Holy Spirit out of the spirit realm, it's going to be right information. But notice it says in this verse, the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord. It's the place where you're illuminated, where you're enlightened. I like to think of it this way, that here's your body, here's your spirit, and your soul. Your soul is what? Your soul is your mind, your reasoning capabilities, your mind, your will, and your emotions. That's what makes up your soul. Your body and your spirit feed information into that soul continually. Now, we've been trained because, not understanding the spirit realm or even knowing that we were a spirit. I was in church many, 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 many years. And if you'd asked me, what's a spirit? Are you a spirit? I couldn't answer that question. Because I wasn't taught about that. And so, we've been trained as we live in this world that we go by our five physical senses so much. The tendency is to want to control our life or make sure everything's right. So we have the reasoning going on all the time. And then, of course, the emotions and the will and all that. And so many times we operate out of our five physical senses through our body in our soul, and we just kind of ignore our human spirit. And when we do that, we ignore the Holy Spirit too. Because it's not the way we have operated for so long. Amen?
Yeah.
But we need to learn to turn that around. We need to grow in our spirit. Brother Kenneth Hagin used to say, you need to train your human spirit, was the language he used in talking about that. I would probably say it more like you need to become more aware of your spirit. Now, when I first heard teaching about this, it was still a mystery to me. It was like, yeah, but what? I need to get, what's a spirit thing? I need to understand this. What is that? Well, your spirit, in the spirit realm, things are established. forever. And so your spirit, man, I've noticed in studying the Holy Spirit and studying the spirit realm in the Bible that usually when it talks about that, there's the word know there somewhere. Your spirit knows things. Sometimes that your mind can't explain.
Amen.
You know, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 talks about the gifts of the Spirit, talks about operating in words of knowledge, words of wisdom. That one thing I mentioned earlier, how Mike, at the end of the service, he just looked within him where the Holy Spirit lives. He asked the Holy Spirit if he had anything, you know, to share with the people. The Bible says we are to desire manifestations of the Spirit.
Yeah.
We're to covet them. Earnestly covet them. That's right. And so, he got a word. Double knee. That made absolutely no sense to his mind. But the Holy Spirit, who the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 2, knows all things and searches all things, even the deep things of God, knew exactly that there was a woman watching over the internet whose son needed a miracle. I'm sure she'd been praying and standing with God. And so he downloaded a word out of Mike's spirit. He gave him a word, as it says in the Bible, of knowledge. And Mike put that out by faith. That made sense to her. She knew who Mike was talking about. And when she... somebody's preaching. as she connected with him in faith on what was happening, then God, through the Holy Spirit, was able to touch that boy's body.
Amen?
Amen.
Yes.
Praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So the spirit of man is a candle of the Lord. Now, you know, the one thing I found is that the best way to start with that or with anything out of the Word of God is to make up your mind it's true.
Yes.
This book is true, friends.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Jesus said his word is truth. Whether you understand it all and how it harmonizes, well, none of us understand it all. We barely scratched the surface, I'm sure, on the revelation that's in the book. But the word is true, and when you make up your mind it's true, and you begin to be a doer of it, and you begin to believe that you can hear from God. See, the Bible says, let God be true and every man a liar. God says, my sheep, are you one of his sheep? Are you in his flock? My sheep know my voice. And another voice they'll not follow. I know the voice of God. Well, how do you know the voice of God? Because God said I did. That's where you start. That's where you start. Now, you may have to learn some things of how to differentiate, because there again, all three parts of your being have three voices. Your physical body, your physical appetites are voices that speak into you and into your mind. How many of you found out about, 12 o'clock every day, the voice of your body says it's time to go to lunch? Amen? We also have the reasoning faculties, the emotions, and so forth. Our soul has a voice, but our spirit has a voice as well. Our spirit has that, what's called in Romans chapter 8, the inward witness. There again, it's a knowing. People are always wanting to hear some kind of voice, like you're hearing my voice right now from God. And God does do that sometimes, but it's the exception and not the rule.
Yes.
But the Holy Spirit's always in you, and he's always willing to witness to you or make you aware of what he knows or what he sees or what he wants to do.
Right.
And so you train yourself to trust that within you. Well, what if I make a mistake? Welcome to the world.
Yeah.
We all make them. Amen. When you were learning to drive, you probably made a mistake or two, but you didn't quit just because you made a mistake or two, did you?
Amen.
You kept learning until you were good at driving. Praise God, or at least I hope you're good now. Amen.
Yes.
Turn to the book of Job. I'm going a little bit, just kind of building a little bit of a foundation here, because I want to get into Hebrews here in a second. Job chapter 32. Let's look at another scripture here. Job chapter 32, verse 8. But there is a spirit in man, and the inspiration, everybody say inspiration.
Inspiration.
The inspiration of the Almighty giveth them understanding. Now see, he's spelling out here how this works. He says, God put a spirit inside you, inside your body. He put you inside your body. Amen? And it says, the inspiration of the Almighty. When Mike got that word of knowledge we're talking about, that was an inspiration. It didn't come out of any kind of deducing things or figuring things out or any kind of natural human way. There was an inspiration that came from the Holy Spirit to give him those words. And when he put them out there by faith, and we connected with that lady in prayer, and the Holy Spirit, you know, she received the word of the Lord. She believed. The Bible says, if you believe the prophet, you'll get the prophet's reward. And the prophet's reward is the anointing that's on the prophet. That was a prophetic word of the Lord. Amen?
Yes.
Praise God. And so the little boy was healed. But there's a spirit in man. The inspiration of the Almighty giveth them understanding. I found that if you'll ask God questions, he'll answer you.
Amen.
I remember one time I was wondering about a certain scripture and some things for a long, long time. And one day I said, Lord, I don't understand that. Would you give me some revelation about it? And I mean, just kaboom, kaboom, kaboom. He let me understand some things. And I said, why didn't you give that to me before? And here's what I heard inside me. He didn't ask me. You have not because you ask not. God loves it when you ask him questions.
Yes, he does.
He loves it. Amen? Now, don't ask him questions he has to write a book to answer. Good to ask him a lot of yes and no questions. It's good to ask him, you know, just keep it simple if you can. But sometimes he'll get down and he'll get it into a little more depth of revelatory understanding in the situation. So the spirit realm is where God lives. It's where, you know, our victory is. When you die physically, when your heart stops, your spirit will leap out of your body and you will be able... How many of you remember the movie Ghost? Anybody remember that movie? Remember, you know, he was dead, and he was over in the spirit realm, and he was trying to talk to his girlfriend, and she didn't even know he was there. Well, this room right now has probably got angels in it.
Amen.
Amen. There's probably all kinds of spiritual activity going on in this room, but we can't contact it because we're in a different realm. We're aware of a different realm more than we're aware of that realm. But we are connected to that realm. You see, your spirit man is always in the spirit. He doesn't go in and out of the spirit. We pay more attention to our soul or the physical natural realm and less attention to that. Amen? You know, John the Revelator said in Revelation, I was in the spirit on the Lord's day. You can be more aware of the spirit realm or less aware. It's just something that happens as you press in to walk with God and know God, and sometimes he'll pull you in there. And God can pull you all the way over into there and let you see things. He can give you what's called discerning of spirits. He can let you see openly in the spirit realm what's going on if he wants to. But there again, that's the exception, not the rule. But the rule is for us to develop to be conscious of what is being prompted in us. You know, I've shared this story before too, but I remember... A few years ago, it's been a number of years back now, but I was at home and I was just doing stuff around the house, and I kept hearing inside me, up in my mind, a question. And the question was, will you go to the nations for me?
Wow.
Now, I wasn't thinking about the nations. I wasn't watching a TV program about the nations. I hadn't had a phone conversation with a missionary about the nations. And that was why I didn't pick up on it probably, because my mind was focused on what I was doing out here in the natural realm. And after about, I don't know, it had to be at least an hour, maybe 2 hours, of that thought, that question, just rising up in my mind, I stopped and go, wait a minute. I keep hearing a question. It's amazing how we can just be so focused out here that we miss what's going on inside us. And I just stopped and I said, Lord, is that you asking me that question or something along that line? And I heard the question again, will you go to the nations for me? And I said, yes, I will. And that was it. He didn't ask me the question anymore. But he was trying to get my attention.
Right.
And he kept coming at me until I responded to what was happening. And that's what I'm talking about with your spirit. It's so easy to be so caught up out here that we can miss what he's trying to say to us in here. So in the spirit realm is where our victory is. Now turn over to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, one of my most favorite books in the Bible. It's a wonderful book about Jesus Christ being our high priest. In Israel, they had 7 redemptive feasts that they, you know, in the Old Testament that they celebrated and that they walked in. When the Lord showed it to me, he showed it to me like a circle of protection. A circle doesn't have any openings for the enemy to get in. And there were seven, which is the number of perfect completion in the Bible. There were seven redemptive feasts that they celebrated every year. And if they did these things from their heart in the right way before the Lord, it kept them in a position in a yearly circle or yearly cycle where the blessing of God would be upon them all the year. And the enemy would not have access. It's when they started getting religious and pretending and going through the motions with their heart not being in it that God would warn them prophetically. I love Isaiah 58. It's where God told Isaiah, lift your voice up like a trumpet and warn the people. They're getting upset at me because the blessing's not on them anymore. And they're not being healed, and this is not happening, and that's not happening. But they are not doing what I told them to do with the right heart.
Wow.
It's an interesting chapter. But these seven feasts, this circle, this cycle, was intended to keep God's people in blessing. And we just had the fall feasts. If you were a Jew, you would have a practicing Jew, you would have celebrated the Feast of Trumpets. You would have celebrated the Day of Atonement. You would have celebrated the Feast of Tabernacles. And the Day of Atonement, this book has got a lot of things in it about the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement was when the high priest, once a year, prepared himself according to the commandments of the Lord through Moses, and he took the blood of an animal, and he went into the Holy of Holies, which is where the Ark of the Covenant was, the mercy seat of God, above the ark, and the literal Shekinah glory presence of God was there in the Holy of Holies. The high priest was able to go in there as he went in according to the way the Lord, commanded that he do, and take that blood and sprinkle it before the Ark of the Covenant seven times. And that sprinkling of blood, when you see sprinkling of blood in the Bible, it's always about sanctifying, making pure, making holy, cleansing, purging. And so he would do that, and if God accepted that sacrifice, when he came out of the Holy of Holies, then the redemption or the forgiveness of sin was instituted for the whole nation from the past year, and their sins were covered by that blood, and God could take them on into the next year, and they could have a blessed year. But it had to come through the high priest, and this book, the book of Hebrews, is about Jesus becoming our high priest. Amen. Jesus was the lamb that died. He provided the blood, but then he rose from the dead 3 days later. And when he rose from the dead, Mary was there at the tomb crying, saying, "What have you done with my Lord?" She thought Jesus was the gardener, the guy taking care of the cemetery there. And she said, "Where have you taken my Lord?" And he spoke to her, and when he spoke to her, she recognized him. She must have been one of his sheep. She knew his voice. And he said to her, "Don't touch me." That sounds kind of different for Jesus. He was touching people all the time and doing all kinds of things, right? But he was, at that point, he had risen from the dead with his own blood, not as a covering, just a cover, not a substitution, but his blood was perfect blood. He was the perfect sacrifice. And so he rose from the dead with his blood to purge sin forever.
Amen.
And he said, "Don't touch me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father and your Father, my God and your God." He was standing as the high priest after he rose from the dead. He was ready to go up into the heavenly Holy of Holies, and it talks about him doing that here in this book. And he went in with his own blood, and he sprinkled his blood on the mercy seat in the heavenly Holy of Holies and purged our sin.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Once and for all. And then he came back down to earth, and he prepared them, for the day of Pentecost and all these kinds of things that happened. But Jesus is now our high priest. Now, this is the heaven is in the spirit realm. This is all in the spirit. And what I want you to see today, I want you to from now on, when you pray, I want you to understand that, I used to see myself when I would pray, I'm down here, God's way up there somewhere. God, how are you? That's kind of how I saw my prayer life. But see, there's a part of me called my spirit. that stands before the throne of God all the time.
All the time.
You don't go from here to there and back and forth.
No.
You're there. You're in his kingdom. You're before him.
Hallelujah.
Now your body's not there yet. The resurrection and the resurrection, those spirits of mankind that have been justified are going to come back to this earth in the resurrection and be reunited with their body, and they're not going to have this body that gets old and hurts and all the other stuff that goes with it. They're going to have that same kind of body Jesus got, that resurrected body, praise God, that could eat fish with the disciples, but yet at the same time disappear. Beat me up, Scotty. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen. We're going to get that, but that hasn't happened yet. But I want you to see, I want you to understand that you are a spirit, and your spirit is always in contact with God.
Praise God.
You're always before him. See, the Old Testament prophets understood this. I remember reading about Elijah and Ahab, who are you? You know, he says, I'm Elijah who stands before the Lord.
Hallelujah.
He understood that because of the office he was standing in, that he'd been given a position in the throne room of heaven. Spiritually. Everybody say spiritually speaking. You know, you read the book of Zechariah, when God was restoring after they had been taken out of the land and they were being brought back in, and he was reinstituting the temple and reinstituting the worship, and he was making Joshua the high priest. He told him, he said, if you'll do what the priest is supposed to do and you'll do it my way, he said, I'll give you places to walk among those that stand by.
Wow.
He's talking about his king's court in heaven. You'll have a voice with me in heaven. Hallelujah. Now here in Hebrews 12, let's look at this. Paul's explaining some of this. Let's begin at verse 18. For you, New Testament Christian, are not come unto the mount that might be touched and that burned with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they being the Hebrews that had come out of Egypt and were at Mount Sinai, he's talking about Mount Sinai here, which voice they heard, entreated that the word should not be spoken unto them anymore. Without going back and looking at this in the Old Testament, what happened was when Moses brought them to the mountain that God told them to bring them to, God spoke and said, I want them to be a kingdom of priests. I want you to come up close to me, Moses, but I want them to stay just far enough away where they can hear me talking to you.
Yeah.
And so they all said, okay, we'll take that deal. We'll go with that. And so they got ready for it, and here comes God with the lightning and the fire and the thunder and the shaking, and it freaked them out. It scared them. Moses, it said, walked up into the fire, and the people backed off and said, no, we turned down the deal now. We want you to talk to God and you tell us what he says. And anybody that tries to live their life with somebody else hearing for God for them ends up just like the children of Israel in a mess.
Amen.
God wants to have a relationship with you. Now, that doesn't mean he won't use other people to teach you things or prophesy to you or minister to you, and his voice will come through other people to you. But it's about you and him walking together.
God.
He's the friend that sticks closer than a brother. He never leaves you nor forsakes you. Amen? So, Paul says here, the writer of Hebrews says here, that we're not like the children of Israel in the natural realm coming to some natural mountain. Drop down to verse 22. He says, but you are come unto. The words come unto there in the original Greek mean to approach as unto location. He says, you are now here.
No.
Here where? You are coming to Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem.
No.
You know, the word Jerusalem, the L-E-M there at the end of the name Jerusalem, makes that a word that there's two of them.
Yeah.
I don't know how to say it the proper way. But if you go over to Israel and you see some of their paintings of Jerusalem, you'll always see an earthly Jerusalem and a heavenly Jerusalem above it. Because they know that's what that word means. And it's true. I mean, all you got to do is get in the book of Revelation and you see that there's a heavenly Jerusalem that comes down to rest upon the earth at the end of days. Amen? But you and I don't have to wait for that to be in that heavenly Jerusalem. Our spirit man is there. Our spirit man is before God. That's what he says here in verse 22. You are come unto Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels. Well, if you read the first part of this book, he makes the case about the angels. You know, people back in those days tried to worship angels too. And he had to, you know, separate, no, you don't worship angels, you worship Jesus. And then he talked about how the angels even worship Jesus, and how that the angels now, because of what Jesus has done for us, have been sent forth, is the word that's used there, to minister to, or to serve, actually the words mean to labor for, those who are going to be the heirs of salvation.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Angels, angels everywhere. Praise God. You got lots of angels. You got so many angels working for you, you can't count them all.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. We need to believe in them and ask the Lord to use them in our lives.
Amen.
To an innumerable company of angels. Now, this is, I want you to see this position before I go on. In this, I'm talking about you taking a position in prayer. When you go to pray, I don't do this every time, but I've trained myself, and I try to do it at least once a day, to close my eyes and see myself before the Lord in heaven. See the angels. See myself in the new Jerusalem there, in the heavenly Jerusalem, because that's where I'm at spiritually. Amen? Here in these scriptures, God's called the judge of all. When you go see a judge here on earth, you can't talk to him from the church here. You've got to go over to the courthouse where he's at.
Amen.
Amen? And God has given... See, the spirit realm is not like the natural realm. This natural realm is time and space, very limited, very slow and limited. The spirit realm is not that way. It's hard for our mind to comprehend that because our brain has been designed and our mind has been designed to comprehend this time and space realm we live in. And we spend so much time focused on that. There again, the spirit realm is kind of like a mystery to us sometimes. But it says here, we are coming to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven. To the general assembly, when God sees all of us in one place. Now on earth, we're in different places, different churches. We got different names on our buildings. But God says, this is the name of my church, the general assembly and church of the firstborn. Who was the firstborn?
Jesus.
He was the first begotten from the dead. He's the firstborn from the dead. Amen?
Yeah.
He fulfilled the feast of first fruits by rising from the dead on the feast of first fruits. Praise God. Mm-hmm. And you and I are the rest of the fruits. Praise God. I'll let you interpret that one. Amen? The general assembly and church of the firstborn. Praise God. We're all in this together.
Amen.
We're connected, praise God, with the saints before us and even the ones that will come after us, which are written in heaven. And to God, notice what he's called here, the judge of all. God, the judge of all. So as I come into prayer, and I realize that I'm standing before the throne of God, and I realize the angels are there, ready to aid and assist me in life here on this earth, ready to, at the beck and command of God, to be released on my behalf, I need to understand and see myself, I'm standing before a judge's bench or a throne. Actually, it's a king's throne is what it is. This is not a democracy, this is a theocracy, the kingdom of God. Amen?
Yeah.
Praise God. You have a voice, but you don't get a vote.
Yes.
You can come to God and talk to him about things. You can reason with him. You can, and he'll listen to you and all that kind of thing. The Bible teaches us that. But he is the final word.
Yes. Amen.
And we need to approach him that way.
Yes, that's right.
I don't want to get too far into this, but everything in the spirit realm is legal. Not I'm not talking about legalism where people are trying to earn their salvation by doing good works.
Yeah.
But I want you to understand that the devil, who is trying to sue you in the courts of heaven every day. The devil, he tries to find a legal reason why he can stop God from answering your petition in the court.
Yes.
Jesus, you know, taught many things, of course, but one of the things he talked about prayer, and, you know, if you have faith, you can say to this mountain, be removed, it'll be cast into the sea. If you doubt not in your heart, you believe what you say. And then he says, therefore, whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe you receive them, and you will have them. And he says, but if you have any ought against anybody,
right,
when you're standing there praying, forgive. Why? Because unforgiveness gives the devil a legal reason to step in and say, God, you can't answer his prayer. He's violating your spiritual principle of forgiveness. In other words, God, here is how it is. God's forgiven us. Who do we think we are to not forgive somebody else? Remember the one parable, the one story that Jesus told about the guy that owed his master, you know, a whole bunch of money and couldn't pay it back? And the master came and said, I forgive you. And so he was forgiven the debt. Then he went to somebody that owed him a little debt. And instead of forgiving the guy, he, you know, was hard on this guy, going to throw him in debtor's prison. And the guy that forgave him the big money came back and he said, boy, now you are really in trouble. That's what Jesus was talking about. We can't go before the throne of God and not walk in love and not walk in that place of forgiveness and that place of being a blessing to people and think that we're going to, you know, somehow we're going to hold somebody to some kind of debt that we think they owe us and that God's going to be able to just freely operate in our life and bless us. Hallelujah.
Very good.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. It's true. Now, I'm not talking about your humanity. This is where the devil used to mess me up all the time. Well, you lost your temper last week and you said da 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 da. Yeah, I did. But I also asked God to forgive me.
Yes.
Amen. It's not, there again, that would be legalism. Trying to somehow have a relationship with God, a perfect spirit, based on me in my human flesh, which is not perfect. It's like oil and water. It's not going to mix. Amen. Did I mess you up on that? Or is that, do you get what I'm saying? Amen. You know, and sometimes we ask God to do things that are unscriptural. And he can't answer that either. It's like me like going to the judge over here. And the law says this, and you come in there and you want the law to say that, and you're asking him to rule in favor on your case, and the prosecutor's going to stand up and says, that's not legal, he can't get that done. Did you ever notice that Jesus, a lot of his teachings were always about the motivation of the heart? The heart motivation. What does the devil always want us to focus on? The failings of our flesh. Amen? But we have to make sure our heart is pure. We're going to miss it. We're going to make mistakes. Things are going to happen sometimes. Things are going to happen a lot. All of the time. Amen. One, you know, Romans 7 is a great chapter for me. I love that. I love reading about how Paul failed in the flesh. It gives me hope. Amen. So it's the heart mode. I was listening to the guy that does the Elijah list. I forget his name now.
Steve Schultz.
He was talking about how he got sick. And he was sick for 7 years. He went down from like 190 pounds to 120 some odd pounds. He was nauseated 24/7. The doctors couldn't figure it out. He prayed. He said, I prayed every kind of prayer I should pray. I repented of everything. I was repenting of things that I didn't even do. He said, I had all the big shots and the little shots lay hands on me. And nothing worked. And he said, one day, 7 years down the road, he said, I got mad. And he said, I yelled out at God, God, you are not doing your job. And he just laid it out there. I believe your word, and you're not doing your part. Da 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 da. And he said, and then I realized, he said, I was thinking I might get struck with a lightning bolt here. So he said, at the end of the prayer, I said, if it be thy will. He said the next day he woke up and he was hungry. And he started coming out of that.
Thank you, Lord.
And he's like, okay, how in the world do I feel? You know, what is this about? I get in God's face and he answers my prayer.
Right.
And so he started asking the Lord, as he got better and better and all that, he started asking, Lord, you're going to have to show me, God, I don't understand this. And he said, the Lord one day spoke to him and said, and it's a scripture, God always quotes his word, doesn't he, most of the time. He said, I desire truth in the inward parts. Inward parts, the spirit of man searches the inward parts of the belly. In other words, Steve was mad at God in his heart. But he was acting like he wasn't. Because we're not supposed to be as Christians. Come on, are you here? And so he really wasn't operating in truth in his situation. It's when he got honest with God and told him how he felt, God could then work with him.
Word.
Yes, yes.
Now, God's always right and we're always wrong. I mean, you know, if there's a debate in that, God's always right and we're not. But there are ways that you can, truth, you know, the Bible tells us when we put on the armor of God, we're to put on the belt of truth. And that word truth, you look it up, it means sincerity. Total open and God doesn't mind you telling him, God, it looks to me like you're not doing your job.
Right.
And then he'll do what he needs to do and he'll help you see how what you thought wasn't true anyway. But we, what I'm saying here is we've got to keep a pure heart. You know, you've heard me say it before. I read that scripture where God spoke to Abraham and he said, Abraham, walk before me and be thou perfect. I read that years ago and I thought, that's the end of me right there.
Exactly.
But you look the word up and it means sincere. It means to keep a pure heart. It means to be honest and open with God. Amen? It's when we play these little religious games. You know, I've had people tell me, I can't forgive. Well, are you smarter than God? He tells you to forgive 144,000 times in one day if you need to. And you're smarter than him. You're saying he's stupid. He told you to do something stupid. No. See, forgiveness is a decision, not a feeling.
Amen.
Your feelings are fickle.
Yeah, come on.
If I handed you a $1 million check right now, your feelings would change.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
If I told you that your house just burnt down, your feelings would change. Amen? But the spirit realm, there again, it's established. It's a thing that you can't, you know, play these kinds of games. And I'm not saying go home and get mad at God and yell at him, but you can go to God, because I've done this, and just say, look, I don't get this, and I need some answers here. You know, we need to, God wants us to do that.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen. Praise God. So it says here that we are, verse 23, the general assembly of the church of the firstborn, which is written in heaven, and to God the judge of all, and to the spirits of just mankind made perfect. That word perfect means to be consecrated or finished or fulfilled. Notice it's not the spirit, souls, and bodies. It's the spirits. People have died, went to heaven, and their spirit being is there with God. And they're part of a company. They're part of that church of the firstborn, and it calls them witnesses. Did you know you have people in your lineage that lived before you that know a lot about you spiritually? And they're in heaven to testify of their lineage and even to testify about you. They're witnesses. They're in court. They're in the courtroom. They're in the throne room. They're a great cloud of witnesses. They're not just in the stands like a football game and just rah, 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 sis, boom, bong. They are witnesses that testify of their lineage. If you read Hebrews chapter 11, it talks about our spiritual heritage from the beginning all the way through and from Abraham on down. And the last verse says that God's given us some better thing than what they had so that they, without us, could not be fully completed.
Amen.
We're all tied together in this thing.
Amen.
My wife had an experience where she saw she was in this big, huge crowd of people on these risers, kind of like a choir would stand on. And there were people that were dressed like we dress today, all the way down through the time frame, down to the biblical characters. And the crowd parted, and a person way down at the bottom that looked like had biblical dress type thing on came up to her and said to her, we are counting on you
Amen.
To finish your part. See, we're tied together with these folks.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Jesus was coming to the end of his life and ministry on this earth, and by the Spirit of God, he was led to take Peter, James, and John and go up to a mountain called the Mount of Transfiguration, up to a high place, and as he began to pray up there, the devils do what? The disciples, sometimes they act like devils, but the disciples did what a lot of us do when we pray, they fell asleep. Jesus was transfigured before them. What was that? The natural curtain was pulled back, and they saw what he looked like in the Spirit, glowing with the glory of God. And Moses, a dead guy, who died many years before that. Elijah, he hadn't died, but he was caught up to heaven. Were there with him, talking to him about the fulfillment of his ministry on the earth. Now, I'm not here to start some different doctrine, but I just have a feeling the great cloud of witnesses play a whole lot more of a role in our lives than what we even realize.
Wow.
You thought your grandma stopped praying for you when she went to heaven. She may have done more for you in heaven than she could ever do on the earth for all we know. But do you see the courtroom setting here? Courtroom settings have witnesses when there's a trial. There's a prosecutor. His name's the devil. But there's a defense attorney. Let's read about him.
Amen.
Verse 24. And to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant. The mediator of the new covenant. He's the one that mediated. He took God's hand and our hand, and with his blood and the cross and all that he did, raising from the dead and being our high priest, he brought us together and made us one. We're one spirit with the Lord.
Yes.
Praise God.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Atonement. At-one-ment. We became one with God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Yeah.
And Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. Jesus' blood is there on the mercy seat. Remember over in Genesis when Cain, who was the first murderer on earth, he killed Abel? And God came and confronted him about it. Where's your brother Abel? And he did what most murderers did. I'm innocent. Am I my brother's keeper? And God says, here's what he said. Your brother's blood cries out to me. Blood has a voice. Blood has a voice. Blood is life. Innocent blood is crying out to God. All the aborted babies that have been aborted in this nation are crying out to God. Their blood is crying out to God.
Yeah.
You ought to study the subject of innocent blood in the Bible. You will be amazed.
Yeah.
God's graceful. He's merciful. He gives us time to repent. But he comes down hard eventually. Mm-hmm. Because he is obligated to make right innocent blood being spilled.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Abortion in this nation is a rights thing and a this and a that people have made it. It's a spiritual thing.
Exactly.
And the devil knows that. That's why he couches it in deception and tries to make it look like something it's not, because he knows that God will be forced to judge our nation eventually if we don't deal with that in the right
exactly.
way.
Yeah.
Now the good thing about it is the blood of Jesus can cleanse that which was done with innocent blood.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Jesus' blood, he was the only innocent man that ever gave his life willingly, the only truly innocent man. Everybody else before that was imperfect. He was perfect, and he willingly gave his blood. And so now we can take the blood of Jesus, and we can repent, and his blood will cleanse and offset what's been done in the taking of innocent blood.
Yes.
It says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful, which means he'll do it every time. He's just, which means it would be unjust for him not to. You think about God, how much he loves us. He purposely put himself through the blood of Jesus and the cross. He purposely put himself as a judge in a position to where when I come to him and I say, Father, forgive me, I've sinned. I ask you to forgive me and cleanse me. He would be an unjust God to turn that down and say no. He'd have to say no to the blood of Jesus. And the blood of Jesus, he cannot say no to the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
So the next time the devil tells you, when you ask for forgiveness for something you told God you'd never do, but you did it for the 18th time, That devil ever play that game with you? Well, how many times have you asked God to forgive you for that? And he used to get me on that. And one day the Lord led me over to 1 John 1:9. He said, do you see a number there? Do you see how many times you sin and then I won't forgive you? Or come to a place where I won't forgive you? Now that doesn't mean he's saying I can live a lifestyle of sin. But what he's saying is that the blood of Jesus is good and it goes beyond my human frailties and failures. Amen? Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant into the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. Abel's blood was crying out for justice, crying out for the vindication of his own innocent life, crying out to God. But Jesus' blood is crying out mercy, crying out grace, crying out, Father, forgive them. I paid the price. Hallelujah. And this word speaketh here is a continual voice in the Greek. It's constant. The Father's sitting on that throne, and he's hearing that blood. And Jesus, my defense attorney, is right there, ready to defend me based on what he did for me. When I come with an honest and sincere and open heart and come before him based on the blood.
Yes.
Not based on, now God, I've gone to church a lot in my life. So you need to heal me.
Come on.
You'll have to say, well, I can't answer that. The devil will say, that's right, you can't answer it, because that's not what the rules are.
Exactly.
Here.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
But when you come, hallelujah. Based on the blood.
Amen.
Yeah.
When you say to God what the blood is saying, what is the blood saying? The blood is saying, you know, I've got a sermon that I preach, you've heard probably if you've been around for a while, the seven times Jesus bled from the time he went to the Garden of Gethsemane all the way through till he died. He bled seven times. Seven's a number of perfect completion. And each one of those times he bled, he was paying the price for another area of our life.
Amen.
So, by his stripes we're healed, right?
Amen.
When they whipped him with that lash, it paid the price for our healing.
Amen.
So I can come before the Father. And I can appeal to the courts of heaven. I can come before the judge. And I can ask the Father to heal my body based on what Jesus has done for me.
Amen.
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 I also want to make sure my heart's right.
Amen.
You know, people, they give their heart to the Lord and then they live their own life, their own way.
Mm-hmm.
You're in rebellion.
Right.
You are in rebellion. Now, if you're a baby Christian, brand new in things, God understands that. He's going to change your diaper. He's going to feed you with the bottle. He's going to carry you around. He's going to take care of you. But there comes a place where you begin to understand things, and you need to, God puts you down and says, hey, Junior, it's time for you to get those little fat baby legs going. It's time for you to start walking by faith.
Amen.
Believe my word. Learn some things. Amen. Move forward. See, I'm obligated to walk in the light of what I know.
Yes.
That's one reason God can't show people a lot of things. He does it out of his mercy, because if he shows it to them, they know it, they're obligated to live in it.
Yes.
He proves us out to see if we're going to be faithful, if he thinks he can trust us with the keys to the car.
Yeah.
So we don't kill ourselves with it.
Yes.
Amen? Praise God. So, in the spirit, when you pray, this is where you're at. This is where you're at. Now look at verse 25, we'll just wind this up. See then that you refuse, and that word refuse means to beg to be released. What happened to the children of Israel? See, he's making the case based on the children of Israel, the mistake they made. When they said, okay, God, we'll do what you tell us to do. We'll be that priest. We'll be that kingdom of priests. See, Israel was, you know, God's chosen people. He didn't choose them because he liked them better than anybody else on the earth. He chose them so he could use them to move through to show the earth who he was so that people could come to know him.
No.
Amen? Matter of fact, in the back in the Old Testament, there's a scripture that said, he says to them, I chose you and I ministered to you in a certain special way first, so I'm going to hold you more accountable than I do other people. Hallelujah. Are you here?
Yes.
Amen. It says, see that you refuse or you don't beg to be released, that you refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escape not which refused him that spake on earth, that Mount Sinai, much more shall we not escape, shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. Now you and I, now that we're in the body of Christ, we are to give our life to him, and we're born again, we're a new babe in Christ, desiring the sincere milk of the word, and then what God wants to do is bring us into discipleship, where he causes us to begin to grow up, eventually to become a mature child of God. Romans chapter 8 says, they that are led by the Spirit of God are the sons, and that word son means a mature son of God. And so he wants to lead us and have us grow eventually completely into the image of Christ. He wants us to be an active part of his kingdom, working with him in prayer. Amen. And we're a priest on this earth. We partake of Jesus' ministry, of his priesthood. That's what he's talking about here. That when we come up before him, we are in Christ, the Bible says. Revelation chapter 1, I believe it's verses 5 and 6, says that God has made us, when we got born again, he made us kings and priests unto our God. This book talks about Jesus, his ministry is the Melchizedek priesthood. And the Melchizedek priesthood out of Genesis was a man who was a king and a priest. We're a priest toward God as we pray, as we see ourselves standing before the throne, as we approach him based on his word, as we approach him, as it says in chapter 4 of this book, it says because Jesus is our high priest and has done what he's done and he's opened the door, we don't have to wait for some natural priest to once a year go into the Holy of Holies. We can go into the spiritual Holy of Holies, into the throne of God at any time, praise God, and we can obtain mercy and grace to help in the time of need. We can go in there as a priest, praying for others, asking God to help, worshiping him and getting help from heaven for people in our prayer life. But then there's also that king ministry, and that's a whole different subject. But the king ministry, it's the same thing he told Adam in the Garden of Eden. He made Adam and Eve, and then he said, take dominion. Kings dominate. They have a kingdom they rule over. Yes. God gave them a garden. He said, dress and keep. The word keep means guard. Take dominion over this thing. Rule over it. People are waiting for God to do things on the earth. The Bible says in Psalm 115 that the heavens are the Lord's, but he's given the earth to the children of men. Yeah. Now, he owns the earth. Psalm 24 says that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof and all they that dwell therein. He owns it, but you and I are to administrate over it. So I can go up before God as a priest and worship him and pray on behalf of others, pray on behalf of my nation, pray on behalf of my relatives, speak his word. You know, if I need to, I can sue the devil, hallelujah, amen, and get him off of my back. True, not bad. Bad out of experience about that. But then I need to come back down here. And I need to walk in that authority on this earth. The first sign that would follow a believer that Jesus talked about in the Great Commission was you'll cast out devils. This doctrine that's in the body of Christ that God's got it all under control. No, he does not. Now, he does have under control when Jesus is going to return, when things are going to... He has those things under control. We can't change those things. But, right away, Adam and Eve, he said, I made all this. I own it all. I'm putting you in charge of it. Now, you dress it, and you keep it, and you watch over it. They didn't do it, and God didn't control the situation. There's a maniacal demon spirit running around called the devil, and a bunch of fallen angels and demons that are making merchandise of people and killing, stealing, and destroying, and you and I have the authority to do something about it. We go into the spirit, because those demons are spirit beings. We go into them, we deal with them in the spirit in prayer, we go before God, we ask him to release his angels. We ask him to fulfill, the things that he said he'd do in his word. And then when you run into the devil in your life and you see him trying to somehow oppress you or mess with your family or your finances or whatever, you point your finger in his face and you tell him in the name of Jesus Christ by the blood of the covenant, take your hands off.
Amen.
There's a time to pray as a priest and there's a time to say as a king.
Yeah.
Kings make decrees.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen? Now we make the decree that comes from heaven. Hallelujah. This is a book of decrees. It's not just promises and the sweet by and the pie in the sky one of these days. The Bible says in the New Testament that all of the promises of God in Jesus are yes and amen.
Hallelujah.
You can have them right now. You can take it from promise to manifestation if you'll stand your ground. Amen? But I want you to see, folks, that when you just close your eyes or you're driving down the road and you begin to worship God, you're not some little peanut down here on the earth just kind of floating around and God's way up. So you are before His throne. I like to say it this way. I heard somebody else say it, and I think it's a good way to say it. From the waist down, we walk on earth. From here up, we're in heaven.
Amen.
That's how Jesus was. He said, I don't do anything unless I see my Father do it. When He was walking around on earth. Why? Because he was connected in His spirit with heaven, with His Father. And He knew that. And He knew that the Holy Spirit would reveal to Him through the mind of Christ. The Bible says we have the mind of Christ now because of the Holy Spirit in us. Over in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. It would be revealed to Him the thoughts, the purposes, the plans of God, and even the visions and so forth of God if need be. And He would move in that by faith and rule and reign on this earth. So we're before the Father. You think about it. What if you got an invitation to come into some king's throne room here on earth, or the president of the United States or something like that? You'd consider that a big honor. We have the honor of living in the throne room of God.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Father, we give You praise tonight. Thank You for Your word. Thank You for the reality of Your word. The reality of Your word. The reality of Your word, Father.
Thank You, dear Lord.
Some of you in this room, you need to go before the throne and sue the devil. You need to take the law that heaven goes by, the Word of God. See, this book to us is exceeding precious promises. It's salvation, it's deliverance, it's healing, it's health, it's love, it's everything that God is for us. But to the devil, this is a legal book that's been bathed and immersed in the blood of Jesus Christ. And when you sue the devil with the law of God's Word and the blood of Jesus, he has no answer. And God will honor. 1 John 1:9. He's faithful. He's just. He'll forgive you of your sin, and He'll cleanse you. He'll make a judgment as God Almighty against the enemy.
Yeah.
Can I tell you one more story real quick?
Yeah.
There was a minister whose son was a youth pastor in another state. He was married, had a child. His wife decided to leave him, go with another man. This young man was devastated. He was he resigned his position, went back to where his parents were living, and didn't live with them, but he lived in the same city they were at. He was just in deep, deep depression. And he said, we prayed for him. We did everything we knew to do to try to help him and talk to him and have other people counsel him and all this kind of stuff. He said he just stayed in this deep, dark cave, this hole of depression. And he said, one day I was praying for him, and this is like a year later or so probably, it was a year or two later, and he said the Lord spoke to him. He says, why don't you bring him before the court of heaven? And he said, Father, what do you mean? And he showed him, you know, the revelation of what we're talking about tonight. And so he said, Father, I bring my son before the courts of heaven, before Your throne, and I plead his case. And he said, God wanted to establish this in him. He said, I literally heard the enemy say he can't have that because of the words he's been speaking over his son.
Wow.
You know, we can't talk out of both sides of our mouth.
Yeah.
Lord's been talking to us a lot about that lately.
Yeah.
Notice that?
Yeah.
And he said, all of a sudden it came back to me. You know, we would pray, oh God, help our son. God, save our son. Bring him out of depression. You know, get him back in what he's called to do. And then we would say, oh, he's so this and he's so that. And he just this and he just that. Why does he do this and why does he do that? Yeah, double-minded. And he said, Lord, You're right. I repent and I ask You to forgive me and cleanse me. by the blood of Jesus. And then he brought that before the case before the Lord again. And the Lord rendered a judgment in his behalf. And I think it was either the next day or the next week, his son called him on the phone. He goes, "Dad, I'm out of it. I don't know what happened. Just all of a sudden, I came out of it." And eventually got back into doing what God had called him to do, and so forth. See, if the devil can find a legal reason, talking about a spiritual reason, I'm not talking about you making a mistake in the flesh one time. I'm talking about something in our hearts, or we're over here asking God to do this, that we're saying this about it, that doesn't line up with what we ask God to do.
Right.
Come on, are you here?
Yeah, Pastor.
The enemy can use that against us. And that's hard for us to do, I know. Because we look at somebody and they're acting goofy or whatever, and we just get upset, mad or whatever, and we say, you know, we're not meaning to try to hurt them or send curses against them or something. But we're putting ourselves in a position. We've got to come into agreement with God.
Yeah, yeah.
If any two agree, harmonize on earth, not just some little one-time prayer, "I agree in Jesus' name that your leg is healed," but there's a harmony, a spiritual harmony. You're harmonizing with God. How can two walk together unless they be agreed?
Yeah.
If God's going this way and you're going that way, then you go this way with God, then you go back that way. We've got to come into that place and find. If you don't know what God's will, find out. Ask Him. He'll show you. Get Scripture for it. Ask Him to show you. He'll show you. And ask Him, "Lord, is there anything that I need to repent of or get rid of or deal with in order for the enemy not to be able to step in here and block my prayer?" Amen. And you watch God change things.
Amen.
Father, I praise you tonight. I thank you for your goodness. I thank you that your word is truth. You are true. You are the judge of all the earth. We have the angels available to us to help. We have the great cloud of witnesses that are testifying, not just of what happened when they were on the earth, not about just what Jesus did, but about what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to do. We're part of that lineage. We put ourselves in the storyline of the Bible. We step into that heritage, that lineage, that spiritual lineage, God, of your family, praise God, your church. Lord, I thank you that we can finish our course on this earth with joy. We can be fulfilled in the fullness of what you called us to be here. And I praise you for it, Father. Thank you for releasing your knowledge, releasing your revelation. Now, there's somebody in here tonight, maybe more than one somebody, that as you've heard this tonight, maybe the Lord has already spoken to you, but if not, when you get home, whether it's tonight or tomorrow or whenever, God's going to start showing you some things where the enemy's been able to sabotage your prayers.
Amen.
And he's not showing it to you to beat you up, make you feel bad.
Right.
He's revealing it to you so you can deal with it by the blood and the name of Jesus. And you can come into that place of agreement with God. And you can petition the court of heaven and the judge of all the earth who's wanting to make a judgment on your behalf in a good way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Be able to turn some things around.
Yes.
Listen to me.
Yes.
Listen to the Holy Ghost. Go with it.
Yes.
And stay with it. And if you mess up, repent, get back in, and keep going with it. Amen?
Yes.
Father, I pray for that.
Yes.
God, it's time for some prayers to be answered. It's time for some things to manifest. It's time, it's time, it's time, it's time, it's time. In Jesus' name. It's time, it's time, it's time. We're not waiting on you. You're waiting on us.
Yes.
We thank you, Father God, for the revelation that's coming forth in this area right now. We thank you, Lord, that as we come before you, Lord, you told us that we're to bless and not curse others. Even our enemies, you want to keep us in that place where you can answer our prayers. We thank you, Father. You've said in your word that when someone curses us, we're not to curse them back, but contrarywise, we're to bless them, knowing that we are to receive a blessing. We bless those that curse us right now in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
We say, Father, help them find your will, your plan, your purpose for their lives in Jesus' name. We release those that have hurt us or harmed us. We make a decision right now to forgive them in Jesus' name. I know that even as we think about it, we still may be hurting in our emotions, but as we continue to bless them and pray for them, you told us to pray for those who despitefully use us. God, you're going to heal our emotions. You're going to heal our hearts and heal our minds. Heal us in any way you need to, and we're going to be able to walk into that place of freedom, praise God, and see them come into the place of freedom as well. Lord, we praise you for it. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Let him talk to you in that area. He wants to help you. He wants to bring you into freedom. He wants you to be put in a position where he can answer what you're asking him to do. Thank you for the blood, Lord. The blood is crying out. The blood of Jesus is crying out for our freedom.
Yes.
We agree with what the blood is saying. We agree with what you did for us here on earth at the cross of Calvary. We agree with that. We harmonize with that. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Well, glory. Let's all just stand up. Right, you got anything?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did this help you tonight?
Yeah.
It may not have helped you, but it helped me. I love to pray and think about these things and meditate on these things. God is opening up revelation like never before in this earth. I believe we're in that time Daniel talked about, where knowledge would increase. You know, we've always talked about computers and, you know, satellites, and that's true. That's all a part of it. But I believe God was talking about the knowledge of his kingdom, that he's going to unwrap that. He's going to reveal that so that we can step into that place and walk as the glorious church. Lord, I thank you for everyone here tonight. Thank you for those that might have watched us over the internet. Lord, I thank you that in Jesus' name, you meet their needs as they come before you. And Lord, whatever this meant to everyone that's here, I pray, God, that they'll be able to process this by your Spirit, and that there'll be freedom, and that we'll hear testimonies of relatives and others, God, that they've been praying for. We'll hear testimonies of breakthrough in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise God.
The Lord actually gave me this earlier.
Okay.
Yeah,
go ahead.
The Lord gave me a word of knowledge earlier today, this afternoon, right after service. And I believe someone in here is just getting really, really attacked in whatever ministry they're doing, or if they're, you know, they're praying for someone, and the devil is just saying that you're not causing any effect, you're not helping them whatsoever, you must stop right now. I just, the Lord just wants to let you know, just don't give up. Progression isn't always visible. Keep going, keep pushing forward. The Lord's right behind you every step of the way.
Man,
yeah.
Praise God, don't give up. You got the devil on the run, hang in there. Anybody else got something? You do?
I thought it was just for me, but I think it's for other people also. When you pray, believe that you receive it, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're telling God what? Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah.
But then what do we do when someone else comes and asks about the same situation?
Start complaining.
Yeah.
Do we tell them what we received from God, or we tell them what the complaint was before we received the answer?
It's a good word there.
You know? What's our testimony? We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony.
Amen.
And the Lord just showed me that, you know, how there's some things that I, in the Spirit, I go, I believe I receive. Glory to God. I know not to do whining prayer, but rejoicing prayer, thanking prayer.
Yeah.
And then someone will come and ask you about the situation, and there it goes out the window.
Amen.
Double-minded man's unstable in all his ways. What about that man think he should receive anything from God? Amen.
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 Amen. Good.
Amen.
It's good. Amen. Well, praise God. Yes.
On what you were saying, I think the man you were talking about was Robert Henderson.
Yeah.
Okay. I've been watching him on YouTube, and I found another lady. And just to help everybody, if you want to go on YouTube, you can hear the teachings, the Courtroom of Heaven. And there's another lady. Her name is Jeanette Strauss. She's written a book on from the Courtroom of Heaven to the Throne of Grace and Mercy.
Mm-hmm.
And God had given her a dream. They'd been praying for her daughter, for their daughter who had been in a bad relationship. And their daughter was raised in church. She was a Christian. I believe she was a worship leader. Got involved with this man, moved in with him, and just was convinced that this was all the right thing. So for like, I think, 5 or 7 years, they were in this relationship. Pulled her out of church, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And God gave her a dream. And in the dream, it was take her to the courtroom.
Amen.
And I believe it was within a week when she, and what Jeanette had to do was recant for the words that she had been speaking over her daughter, praying for her daughter, and then speaking the negative. Within a week, I believe it was, her daughter came to our house and said, "Mom, it's gone. I can't believe it. I'm ending this relationship." But the veil was just ripped off.
Amen.
Just that quick, because she took her. She went into court and said, "Say, repented for everything, repented for her daughter, repented for everything they've been saying," and said, "Now God, move her into the throne room of grace and mercy."
Hallelujah.
And then it was over.
Praise God. Amen.
And she's on YouTube also.
Yeah. Annette.
Jeanette
Strauss.
Yeah.
Praise God. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Have a great week. Be blessed.